Hello, my name is Cahleb Derry, a Harvard class of 2020, and what you are about to see are the performances that were submitted by students and other Harvard affiliates alike during our virtual arts first festival performance fair back in April 2021. I was the MC on this night, and I can assure you that this is an extraordinary, awesome lineup of artistic expression, even despite it being a pandemic. So on behalf of the Office of the Arts and also Harvard and also myself, I'm happy to welcome you to this incredible virtual playlist of outstanding arts. Please enjoy.
This is boring, dude. The percussion part is just one triangle hit at the end. I'm going home.
Aren't you home already?
I mean, good point, but like, this is a snooze.
You can't just leave. We need that triangle hit. It's what makes it art.
Okay, but if I'm gonna stay, I'm gonna play more than one note.
Can you guys be quiet?
Sorry. Maybe you could add a little something to make it more interesting. I don't think anyone would mind.
Okay, I gotcha. How about this?
Not bad. But can you give it a little, you know, something extra?
Like this?
Yeah, that's great.
Thank you. It's a play about survival and also magic. Luz is a 14-year-old girl who is trying to grow up in an upside-down world. She starts to hear voices and see ghosts and begins to think that she's God. It's also a story of my family.
It becomes the story of my great-grandmother. Because over the course of the play, one of the ghosts that Luz comes to know is the ghost of her deceased maternal grandmother. And this is where our two stories begin to overlap. My family is from Lithuania, and my great-grandmother was born in the forest outside of Vilnius to a family of poor Jewish peasants who could not afford to have her. She was one of seven children. So when she turned six, they found her a job in a neighboring village pouring hot coffee and tea for someone they knew and put her on a horse and sent her away. So she worked at this cafe for a year, and by the time she was seven, she was so depressed and missed home so much that she found some strange courage, and one day she stepped on top of the table in the middle of her shift and took a pot of boiling water and she poured it down her arms. When her parents saw her, they said, "That's enough. We can't live like this. We're leaving Lithuania. We're moving to America." And soon after, the Nazis invaded. My family survived because of that child and her brave, strange instinct. So I share this story because it teaches us supreme resilience. Now is the time for resilience, for survival. We are surviving in a crazy time. So what is my play now? Maybe just a reminder that you are brave, that you matter, and that your instincts are brilliant. My name is Rebecca Deutsch, and I'm a playwright and a sculptor and an elementary school teacher in Oakland. I've devoted my life and career to guiding children through the creation of new performance and devised theater. I believe this is the way to create radical human beings that are ready to engage a changing world. This is a way of reifying courtesy. This is a way of creating democracy, fostering empathy, and generating love. So I will leave you with this. This past August, we had terrible wildfires in California. On August 19th, my family home burned. The fire has exposed some incredible root systems of redwood trees. Root systems that I think will be instructive. Because the crazy thing about redwoods are they grow over 300 feet tall, but their roots are only 5 feet deep. They build their exceptional strength and resilience by reaching out sideways and intertwining their roots with the trees around them. So what is my charge? Am I bringing up kids who are expert drawers, expert painters, builders, performers? Or am I bringing up kids that are expert collaborators, expert sharers, co-conspirators, who know how to take an idea and make it a practice where no idea is too small, and help set them up to live radical, engaged, expansive lives? I think that's what it's all about. So here I go.
I met a man without a dollar to his name, who had no traits of any value but his smile. I met a man who had no yearn or claim to fame, who was content to let life pass him for a while. But I was sure that all I ever wanted was the life like the movie stars led. And he kissed me right here and he said, I'll give you stars and the moon and a soul to guide you and a promise I'll never go. I'll give you hope to bring out all the life inside you and a strength that will help you grow. I'll give you truth and a future that's 20 times better than any Hollywood plot. And I thought, you know, I'd rather have a yacht. I met a man who lived his life out on the road, who left a wife and kids in Portland on a whim. I met a man whose fire and passion always showed, who asked if I could spare a week to ride with him. But I was sure that all I ever wanted was a life that was scripted and planned. And he said, but you don't understand. I'll give you stars and the moon and the open highway and a river beneath your feet. I'll give you days full of dreams if you travel my way on a summer you can't repeat. I'll give you nights full of passion and days of adventure, no strings, just warm summer rain. And I thought, you know, I'd rather have champagne. I met a man who had a fortune in the bank, who had retired at age 30, set for life. I met a man and didn't know which stars to thank. And then he asked one day if I would be his wife. And I looked up and all that I could think of was the life I had dreamt I would live. And I said to him, what will you give? I'll give you cars and a townhouse in Turtle Bay and a fur and a diamond ring. And we'll get married in Spain on my yacht today and we'll honeymoon in the Beijing. And you'll meet stars in the parties they throw in my villas in Nice and Paris in June. And I thought, okay. And I took a breath and I got my yacht. And the years went by, and it never changed, and it never grew, and I never dreamed. And I woke one day, and I looked around, and I thought, my God, I'll never have the moon.
Thank you. He jests at scars that never felt a wound. But soft, what light through yonder window breaks? It is the east, and Juliet is the sun. Arise, fair sun, and kill the envious moon, who is already sick and pale with grief that thou, her maid, art far more fair than she. Be not her maid, since she is envious. Her vestal livery is but sick and green, and none but fools do wear it. Cast it off. It is my lady. Oh, it is my love. Oh, that she knew she were. She speaks, yet she says nothing. What of that? Her eye discourses. I will answer it. I am too bold. 'Tis not to me she speaks. Two of the brightest stars in all the heaven, having some business, do entreat her eyes to twinkle in their spheres till they return. What if her eyes were there, they in her head? Oh, the brightness of her cheek would shame those stars as daylight doth a lamp. Her eye in heaven would through the airy region stream so bright that birds would sing and think it were not night. See how she leans her cheek upon her hand. Oh, that I were a glove upon that hand, that I might touch that cheek. She speaks. Oh, speak again, bright angel, for thou art as glorious this night, being o'er my head as is a winged messenger of heaven, up to the white, upturned, wondering eyes of mortals that fall back to gaze on him as he bestrides the lazy passing clouds and sails upon the bosom of the air.
Dreams don't give credit to Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. To be or not to be? That is the question. Whether 'tis nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against a sea of troubles, and by opposing, end them. To die. To sleep. No more. And by asleep to say we end the heartache and the thousand natural shocks that flesh is heir to. 'Tis a consummation devoutly to be wished. To die. To sleep. To sleep perchance to dream. Aye, there's the rub. For in that sleep of death, what dreams may come when we have shuffled off this mortal coil must give us pause. There's the respect that brings calamity of so long life. For who would bear the whips and scorns of time? The oppressor's wrong, the proud man's contumely, the pains of disprized love, the law's delay, the insolence of office, and the spurns that patient merit of the unworthy takes, when he himself might his quietus make with a bare bodkin. Who would fardels bear to grunt and sweat under a weary life, but that the dread of something after death, the undiscovered country from whose bourne no traveler returns, puzzles the will, and makes us rather bear those ills we have than fly to others we know not of. Thus conscience does make cowards of us all. And thus the native hue of resolution is sicklied o'er with a pale cast of thought. And enterprises of great pith and moment with disregard the currents turn awry and lose the name of action.
And the Thank you.